we assume that is equal to left atrial pressure, that is same as that of the pulmonary artery occlusion pressure, that is same as that of left ventricular end-diastolic pressure, that is as equivalent to that of the left ventricular end-diastolic volume. So lots of assumptions we are making so that we conclude. So if you measure right atrial pressure, we are assuming that is same as that of the left ventricular end-diastolic volume. Lots of assumption. If anything happened in terms of pathophysiology in between this assumption, means if they have tricuspid wall regurgitation, tricuspid stenosis, pulmonary artery stenosis, okay, mitral regurgitation, stenosis and all, so this assumption is not going to be valid. So this is the major limitation of CVP, why it doesn't tells about clearly about the left ventricular end diastolic volume. So basically, so preload, what we are interested is left ventricular end diastolic volume. So, but we are assuming, so right atrial pressure is equal to that of the right ventricular end diastolic pressure, that is same as that of pulmonary artery occlusion pressure, that is same as that of pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, that is same as that of left atrial pressure, that is equivalent to left ventricular end diastolic pressure, that is same as that of left ventricular end diastolic volume. So we are assuming left is same as that of the right, so volume is same as that of the pressure. So in an intact heart, then only this left ventricular end diastolic volume is going to be right ventricular end diastolic volume. Otherwise, whenever there is a pathology in between these assumptions, it is not going to be valid. Okay, so this is the major limitation. So beforehand, we were thinking when a patient is having low CVP, if you give volume, so they always are going to increase in the cardiac output. So means like they are going to have some sort of preload responder. So in critically ill patient, the mean rate of responder to volume expansion is only happens in about 50% of the patient, okay? We assume low CVP, give the fluid, only in about 50% they are able to increase the stroke volume in response to preload what we are going to give. So in another 50%, there is no increase in the stroke volume. So they are going to called as preload non-responders, okay? Unnecessary, we are going to give volume overload, which is going to cause extravasation in terms of pulmonary congestion. So basically, if you measure CVP and give fluid, and like, are they going to respond to the fluid? It is like flipping a coin. Either it may be head or it may be tail. So basically, traditional use of CVP, which is more than 12, is equal to pulmonary artery occlusion pressure of more than 18, is not having any scientific rationale at this moment. So lots of data available. Okay, only few studies which showed benefit of CVP in predicting the fluid responsiveness was in animal studies, that too in standing horses. Okay, so it is currently very clear CVP is having a very poor prediction in terms of getting an idea about the fluid responsiveness. So it means patient who had low CVP, we given fluid, they have not responded. Patient who are having high CVP, we given fluid, they responded. So both can happen in permutation combination. That's why, so doesn't mean CVP tells about fluid responsiveness in all the patient. It is like just flipping a coin. Only 50% they are going to have some fluid responsiveness. Okay, so why it is so? Because CVP is having lots of confounding factor. Even when a patient is having high CVP, it doesn't mean they are adequately volume loaded. So only one reason is if they are having hypervolemia, the patient is having forced exhalation, tension pneumothorax, congestive heart failure, massive pleural effusion, okay, so abdominal distension, intra-abdominal compartment syndrome, massive ascites, okay, so cardiac tamponade, if the patient is on IP, pulmonary artery hypertension, pulmonary embolism, tricuspid regurgitation, tricuspid stenosis, all these things will give rise to increase in CVP. So increase in CVP doesn't mean they are having adequate intravascular volume. So lots of limitation. But if the patient is having low CVP, at least we can give some value. Okay, patient is having low CVP, we can consider giving some sort of volume, because so most of the time, if the patient is having low CVP, either it's going to be distributive shock, deep inhalation, or it is because of the hypovolemia. Unless otherwise, patient had cardiac rupture. Okay, so low CVP means patient is having preload deficit. Okay, low CVP means the CVP is going negative RCVP is 2-3 like that. So then patient might respond to fluid. Okay. So till now we just understood what are the assumptions and all. So next is when to measure CVP and where to measure CVP.